In this lecture, we're going to go over why the architecture and structure of your solutions is such a big deal. Now, if you've been following my other lectures so far, there's a good chance that you could be actually doing a lot of this already. Now, at the same time, you may have watched all the different lectures and thought, hey, wow, that's a neat tip or trick. And, you know, we've covered off things like Power Query, tables, pivot tables, and pivot charts. And each of these on their own will absolutely make your life a lot easier. But together, this is where things start to become really, really powerful. And so I wanted to take a step back to zoom out and take a look at, well, how exactly do all of these fit together? Why is it so important that all of these follow a certain sequence? How should you actually be thinking about your work and your models as you start to piece these together? Especially since in some areas, it's a little bit less clear. There are overlaps between, say, in tables and Power Query, you can both create calculated columns. Where should you put them? Aggregation of data, again, you can either do that in pivot tables or Power Query. Which option should you pick? So we're going to start to go over some of those things in this lecture here, as well as cover other little subtleties that are important when you're actually putting together your models. So I've put together this slide here, which is the four layers of reporting and analytics. And what I want you to start doing is start thinking not just as an analyst or kind of these like individual processes that you need to put together a piece of work, but I want you to start thinking a little bit like a software developer. And what software developers do is that they build up things in layers. So here we have the four layers of some reporting and analytics, starting with getting and transforming out data. So get and transform is actually also the name of the feature in Excel 2016, also known as Power Query in Excel 2010 and Excel 2013. This is the first step where we, whatever data that we get, whether we're getting it from an Excel file, a CSV, or even some sort of Hadoop cluster, this is where we pull the data into our model to start working with. Now, a lot of times, especially when you're working with larger data sets or messy data sets, this is the kind of stage of the process where you want to be shrinking your data down so it is small enough to fit inside of Excel, and that the data is relevant to the model that you're actually building. Also, the cleanup processes. Instead of doing any manual cleanup processes anywhere else in the process, you really want to be doing it in this first layer. Now, when you click the load data from get and transform, it automatically loads into a table structure. Now, this is the default option. Now, there are a few other options as well. Like for instance, if you're using Power Pivot, you can load it directly to the data model, which can actually make your spreadsheet file size much, much, much smaller, and enable you to work with larger data sets. For those of you who don't have Power Pivot installed, for instance, in Excel 2016, you can only use Power Pivot if you have a very specific version of Excel 2016, which is a bit of a shame. If you have Excel 2010 or Excel 2013, you can install it as a separate add-in. Anyway, the other way that you can load in data besides the Power Pivot data model is using pivot tables. You can basically load the data to the pivot cache. This also makes it smaller, not as small as a Power Pivot data model, but anyway, there you go. Now, most of the time though, you're going to be loading data to a table. This allows you to quickly, easily filter the data. You can add some additional calculated columns here. Now, coming back to one of the points I was mentioning earlier, should you be adding your calculated columns to your tables or to Power Query? The short answer of it is, if the calculation needs to be dynamic, for instance, if you have some sort of driver, like you have some sort of sheet where you put in inputs where you're changing a number and you want that to reflect in your model, then it should be done at the tables level. If it is part of your just general data transformation, for example, the most common one is, say, something like a vlookup. You don't want to be doing that in the table stage because it will take up a lot of processing and memory. You want to be doing that at the get and transform stage because it does all of the work up front and then no longer impacts the performance of your spreadsheet after that data is loaded. Now, another quick little tip, even if you are building models with drivers, you can also do the calculation at the get and transform stage if your model is just too big and too heavy. So you can have an input sheet, which is a table, which then feeds back into get and transform to do all the calculations up front and have it feed back through. So the benefit of this is, again, if your spreadsheet is getting too big, too heavy, you can offload that work to earlier stages and it'll run up front. But again, the downside to this is that it won't be dynamic. It won't reflect straight away. You'll have to hit a refresh button for it to recalculate. Whereas if the calculation's in the table inside your models, then as soon as you do something, it will reflect straight away. And so if you're using things like GoalSeek, Solver to run optimizations on your model, then that is the better way to go. Now, the next stage is once you have your data in your tables, the next part of it is you're going to want to do some sort of exploration on the data, some sort of summarization of the data. And the most typical way to do that is using pivot tables. Pivot tables are a great feature for quickly exploring your data, running summaries off of it, and that we can then later on use for presentation. Now, again, a summarization of data can either be done at the pivot table stage or the Power Query stage. When you load more data into your spreadsheet, it will run slower, basically. So if you load your data at the Power Query stage and you summarize it at the Power Query stage, then it reduces the amount of data that's loaded into your spreadsheet, so your spreadsheets will run much faster. Also, there may be, say, sensitive data in your original data set, or there may just be data which is completely irrelevant for your analysis or model. By filtering all of those out and summarizing them at the Power Query stage, you'll make your spreadsheet run faster and also be much more relevant for the users. Pivot tables, on the other hand, they're much more dynamic. It's much easier to quickly, you know, change out the rows, the groupings, the summaries, all that kind of stuff at the pivot table layer. Now, most of the time, this is all that people do because a lot of people don't even know that Power Query even exists. So a lot of the summarization often gets done at the pivot table layer. Now, as an analyst, it is a lot faster to work that way. However, once you want to package your work up and send it to a client or some end user to finally actually use your model, then you really want to review that and go, okay, well, actually, maybe I do want to be sending some of these aggregations which I've done in the pivot table layer for myself, for my own analysis, and pop them back into get and transform. Now, the final layer of this is the visualization and presentation layer. So as you would have seen from other lectures, we're able to build quite nice visualizations and dynamic interactive dashboards using nothing but pivot charts, which run off the pivot tables. These run very quickly, very efficiently, and have some nice features there. Now, the real benefit of using these type of visualizations, as opposed to, I suppose, other kind of other charts or other ways of presenting your data, is that it is dynamic and it can refresh quite easily, which is the other important point about this whole overall structure, that actually everything is linked. So the pivot charts are linked to the pivot tables. So you update the pivot tables, it updates the pivot charts. And again, the pivot tables are linked to the tables. So you update the tables, you automatically update the pivot tables. And again, Power Query. You update Power Query and it automatically updates your tables. Now, to keep this working nice and smoothly, what's important is that you don't inject manual steps within these processes. So manual steps are the things that make your life difficult, right? Because when you come to refresh your data, all the manual steps, you need to remember them. So you probably have to write down some process notes and then do them all again. So by avoiding any of those manual steps, then you can really avoid a lot of work. So let's get a little bit more explicit about what exactly these kind of manual steps are. So for example, if you're adding some sort of calculated column, if you have to insert a row or a column or something like that into your tables, then that should really be done at the Power Query stage, because the Power Query will record that insertion of a column as a step that will work off your raw data. If you insert a column at the table level, that is a manual step, and as soon as you refresh your data, that step will be gone. So that's an important point to keep in mind there. Also, we want to be avoiding any copying and pasting. If you're doing any sort of copying and pasting within your workflow, then you really want to review that to see if you can take that out. Now, you may have noticed me using a little bit of copying and pasting every now and then. For example, in one of my lectures, I was copying and pasting pivot tables. But the thing to keep in mind there is that I'm not actually copying and pasting any of the data. What I'm doing is I'm copying the pivot table structure, which can then be reused. So when I copy one pivot table to somewhere else, the pivot table structure is in place so that I can actually just change the rows and columns, and that still works. If you copy and paste the data from a pivot table, it's no longer able to be updated anymore because it's only data. You can't change the rows or columns. If your source data refreshes, that pivot table is not going to be updated anymore. So it's important not to do those types of copies and pastes. Another example, which is maybe a little bit more subtle, is that how do you actually get data into your model in the first place? Now, what a lot of people do is they just get a file, they double click it, and it opens up in Excel and they start working on it. So even in some lectures, I've shown how you can convert a data set very quickly to a table using a shortcut key like Control T. It turns everything to a table, and then you can do the top three layers of this process. What is the problem with that? The problem with that is that as soon as your data gets updated and you want to reuse your model with a new data set or updated data set, then you've just introduced a manual step and process. In order to refresh your data, you might have to do something like copy and paste the data from your table back in there. And when the size of the data changes, again, if you're inserting rows or columns or any of that kind of thing, there's a, you'll basically paste over the structure and either end up having to redo some of those steps, which often breaks a lot of your model, or you just end up having to build the top three layers all over again from scratch. So by adding this extra layer of using the get and transform to load in your data, which for a lot of people is quite a sort of, it's this kind of unnatural step, right? Instead of like just double clicking on the file to open it, you actually have to go into Excel, click get and transform, and then load up your data that way instead. But having this one extra step actually makes a really big difference, because anytime you want to update your data, you basically just hit the refresh button. And that is really the goal of all of this, that, you know, by layering our applications and putting all these together in this kind of structure, anytime we need to make sort of any update, it's very, very easy to do so. If you missed a sort of column of data or something like that, or you could just tweak your queries, modify it in the base layer of our model, and have it reflect all the way through. This is really, really powerful. Something that you always want to keep in your mind when you're building out your models.